C4 and Bryan Nehman.
WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
Well, Marylanders were very pleased to learn that the FBI will be located in Greenbelt, Maryland. It's the best place for the FBI. The General Services Administration made the right decision for the taxpayer and for the mission of the FBI. And congratulations to Team Maryland. We worked together as a team to make this happen, and we're very, very happy with the results.
That is United States Senator Ben Cardin, Joe Robinson, who is sitting in today for Bryan Nehman, talking about the Maryland team for now well over 15 years has been lobbying the General Services Administration of the United States to get old FBI to move into Maryland. The announcement was made last night. It's coming to Greenbelt, Maryland. One of Team Maryland joins us right now. Maryland Congressman, Democrat David Trone is on board with us. Good morning, Congressman.
Good morning to you.
Look, let's begin there with the FBI making a decision to come here. As Senator Cardin said, this was a team effort by the members of the House as well as Senator Van Hollen and Senator Cardin. Talk about why you felt it was so important to push for the FBI building to be relocated here in Maryland, Congressman.
Well, it's a major 7,000, 8,000 jobs be located right in Greenbelt and as the headquarters, and a lot of other jobs are going to follow all around that area. It's also a matter of equity. I mean, we deserve something in Prince George's County. So many government facilities are going to Virginia. Prince George's County has a great, great area that can, where the FBI will thrive. And Team Maryland put it together, led by Senator Cardin. Appropriators are, I think, going to be the key hereafter. We've got to figure out how to get the dollars appropriated here. And luckily, Team Maryland has three Democratic appropriators, which is the most of, other than California, virtually any state. That's a big win for Maryland.
Yeah, for sure. Where do you think things are currently with the government shutdown? Looks like November 7th is the date that's being bandied about.
17th, yep.
What did I say?
7th.
There
that's
you
okay,
go.
17th.
Only, go ahead. It's in the past, right? Sorry.
Yeah, 17th will be the day. We've got a real battle. I mean, Speaker Johnson, only 7 of the 12 appropriation bills passed. I mean, that's just terrible. I'm on the Appropriations Committee, and years past, virtually every bill would have been passed before the August recess. Instead, now it's just over half. So he's got a real problem pulling his party together. He does not seem to want to take a bipartisan approach. He does not want to abide by the debt ceiling deal that we made last summer. I mean, they're not even following their own agreement.
Congressman David Trone is on board with us. Also, he is a candidate for the Democratic side for United States Senate, as Senator Ben Cardin, who we interviewed just a couple of weeks ago, is stepping aside. And we'll, you know, get a question with the congressman about that later on. But let's stay on the Washington, D.C. front, Congressman, and talk about what's currently happening with the bill that Speaker Johnson pushed out, $14.3 billion just for Israeli funding. And the United States Senate basically saying we want Ukrainian funding as well as some funding for the border and some stuff for Taiwan. Where do you see this loggerhead, this jam going? How do you see this working itself out, Congressman?
Yeah, we've got to look at an aid package that's going to cover everybody. And the package that he passed was a dangerous precedent in that it only included aid for Israel and it made it conditional on cutting IRS funding. So his bill actually cost government $30 billion was the cost by cutting the IRS funding, which already was passed under President Biden. And every dollar we give the IRS, $4 comes back. They've got to audit millionaires, and when you look at the number of millionaires audited, it's like a straight hockey stick down. And if we don't do those audits, we're not going to pull in the tax revenue, then we can't take care of our social services. We've got to audit folks in the top tax brackets, and the Republicans don't want to do that.
It's been about 2 weeks since Mike Johnson was elected as the Speaker of the House. How are things going?
I'd say bumpy. I mean, we get done last night. 11 o'clock. I mean, what are you doing voting at 11 o'clock on meaningless amendments? That's not how government ought to work. I mean, government is broken.
So, Congressman, when you say government is broken, do you believe now that when it comes to Speaker Mike Johnson, that they, because, you know, it takes one congressman to stand up and kind of do what we saw happen to former Speaker McCarthy. Do you believe he can keep things somewhat under control, or do you see a mutiny coming down the road?
Now, the folks that are likely to mutiny, the 20 hard right-wing Republicans that are just crazy and would be happy to have government shut down, you know, led by Matt Gaetz. That group's already had their moment in the sun. They shut government down. We had 19 speaker votes. It was a circus, total MAGA circus. And, you know, they're not going to go back to that again. It made them look like the incompetents that they are, that don't want to take care of people and don't want to help move America forward.
When it comes to where we are with Amtrak and with trains, it was a big announcement made by the president the other day about billions of dollars coming on this East Corridor for Amtrak and trains. You're on the Appropriations Committee, the Funding Committee. How important was it to see this money coming to really rehabilitate this whole East Corridor run of Mark and Amtrak?
You hit on a great point there. We've got to figure out better ways for public transportation. $7 billion, that comes to Maryland, and that east-west north-south corridor we have here is the key corridor in the United States. That's infrastructure money that President Biden passed in the bipartisan infrastructure bill roughly 2 years ago. It's a game changer. We're the only country in the world that doesn't have high-speed rail, and this Amtrak will not even give us the high-speed rail that we deserve. The average Amtrak goes 95 miles an hour on average at its peak. Hmm. They talk about it going 165. That's baloney. 95 is as fast as it goes. We need real high-speed rail like they have in Japan, China, even Egypt, Brazil, that goes 250, 350 miles an hour. That's what America ought to have, and that's the best high-speed rail anywhere. That's investing in our future. And that's what we should be doing more of.
You know, I agree with that, but is there any studies about whether or not it would be used? That always seems to be the bugaboo with that type of transportation, is will it be used?
Yeah, everything I've seen on it says it will be used, and it's really important for our green economy. Europe is moving all airplane flights 2 hours or less. They're looking to eliminate those flights or reduce them greatly and replace them with high-speed rail. The time it takes to get to the airport, to go through all the security areas, et cetera, the high-speed rail gets you there faster than the airplane, and the carbon emissions are, like, remarkably, mind-bogglingly better on high-speed rail. Things like maglev or levitates, and we don't have all those carbon emissions. So it's a winning technology. There's a lot of winning technologies out there, but we don't think long-term. We're just thinking about today, and that's a sad thing about government.
Well, speaking of Congressman David Trone is on both, though. Speaking of thinking about today, when I was in the state Senate, Congressman Trone, 2 decades ago, we were talking about the maglev train. I was on a committee working with D.C., Delaware, and legislators from New York looking at the maglev, and this was 20 years ago. So the fact that we haven't, you know, gone to magnetic levitation trains in 20 years, it just wonder if the political will even exists to go in that direction.
Yeah, I'm not surprised, and that's fascinating. I mean, you saw how effective it can be. Yep. And how green it can be. And people, I mean, all over the world, these high-speed trains are working. They're running full. The companies create jobs. They make a profit. And we save on the environment for our kids and our grandkids. And yet government doesn't want to change. It's literally a rigged system. It's rigged in favor of the no change. And that's why we've got to get, you know, all the PAC and lobby money out of it. Because the PAC and lobby money says no change, and that's what we get. And people lose.
You know, Congressman Trone, since you mentioned a lot about, you know, where we need to go green-wise, you and Senator Merkley introduced, along with, I guess it's Congressman Huffman, legislation to take on the plastic pollution crisis. Can you talk about the end of last month, the legislation that you all were talking about?
Yeah, plastic pollution is just something that is unnecessary, and we can do so much better. And so we tried to really draw a bright light you know, on this area, and we receive very much across the board support. But, you know, we've got to hold these companies that create this plastic and then it goes and clogs up our environment, and got to hold them accountable. But once again, you know, big business is not being held accountable. And, you know, that's really important. I think we're going to get good success on this legislation because it's common sense. Government shouldn't be hard. It should be common sense.
Finally, before I let you go, Congressman David Trone joins us once again, also a Democratic candidate for United States Senate. I do have to ask you, because it was a big deal, the Maryland State Education Association, top teachers union in the state of Maryland, came out with an endorsement for you running for U.S. Senate. And like I say, with the endorsements that Angela Alsobrooks was lining up, it was like, wow, you got the MSCA endorsement. Can you talk about the significance of the teachers union endorsement to your campaign?
No, it was a big deal. My mom was a public school teacher in Greenbelt, Maryland, and we're a public school family, and we know that education is the answer to everything in our society. If we can get education right, we can get better jobs, we can cut back on crime, and to get 75,000 educators and teachers to endorse us, it's the biggest endorsement, frankly, in the race. So we were really honored to receive that.
Well, Congressman David Trone, we get a chance, hopefully, before the campaign gets hot and heavy next year, to get you back on. We'd like to catch up with you, okay?
That'd be great. Let us know.
I appreciate it. Maryland Congressman David Trone.